Yeah,
wow.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. Enjoying that 90 degree weather we've already had. Wow, just think of August is just around the corner.
Yeah.
Wow. Well, I hope that you've had a good week, that you've been blessed, and that the Holy Spirit has been ruling and reigning in your life. Amen. Praise the Lord. Why don't you just take a few minutes and shake some hands, hug some necks, and maybe somebody will think you're friendly.
I didn't ask anybody to be in charge of my kids. I never think about it.
They're fine. David's got the one, and then the other one's fine.
Okay.
Kendra. I want to say Kim.
He was
Kendra. Because he was named in the Bible name. Right, Kendra.
Brooke Kendra.
And I know that, but I have a cousin named Kendra, and so I keep wanting to say.
Well, because Kim's name is Kim, but he was named for his middle name, Lee, Kendra Lee, and then his dad's middle name is Brant, so he's named Kendra Lee Brant.
So Kendra's sitting by Noah, and the other one was by Dad, so I don't know. I told him he could sit by Kendra and Noah if he wanted to.
How cute that matches someone.
Cute.
Did you make it?
Oh, no. No, it's actually some of my mother's beads that I couldn't get rid of, you know? I have lots of boxes that I couldn't get rid of, and as I go along, I'm able to let go of a little bit more, but I can't.
Let me see them before you let go.
I keep thinking I'm going to go to her house and raid her closet.
Yeah. You should.
But I need
For all those who are in the body of Christ. We're going to bless the elements and then move them back to the double doors. At any time during the service you feel led, during the worship, prayer time, praise time, preaching, just whenever, it doesn't bother us at all. Just go back and spend a private moment with the Lord. And as I always do, I encourage you, don't be in a hurry. Just stand in his presence and see if he will speak to you. We want to welcome all those who are joining us via the live stream this morning. We're not on yet? Well, never mind then. We need to pray for this computer business. Seems like there's always something going wrong with the computer. How many of you have trouble with your home computers? Man, every time I turn it on, something goes buggy with it. And here at the church, just about every Sunday, we have difficulty getting online with our stream, and there are people waiting breathlessly to join us in the service. So they're going to be working on that. Let's bless the elements. With this cup, I remember thee, and the blood that was shed for me, and this bread we break and eat, bowing brokenhearted at your feet. We remember. Lord, we come to your table today thanking you for all the good things of life, for health and strength, for breath in our lungs. We thank you for the gift of salvation that came through your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you for the sacrifice that was made, for the blood that was poured out, for your body that was bruised, lacerated, torn. Father, for all that your Son went through, we want to say thank you, because it has purchased us off of the auction block of sin. Lord, I pray today that everyone in this house will have a sense of your power and your glory. Your presence will fill the house. Holy Spirit, we invite you to come and do what only you can do, and that's change lives. We make ourselves available to you, Holy Spirit. Help us to worship, to praise, to do so from the very depths of our spirits. Again, I pray a blessing upon each one who is here, our guest, our family members who are here. Thank you. We dedicate this service to you, and we pray that everything that you see and hear in us will bring joy to your heart. Lord, lead us in every step of this service. Give us eyes to see and ears to hear. Cause us to be quick to follow in the footsteps of the Holy Spirit. In the powerful name of Jesus, we pray. And everyone said, Amen. You are good and your mercy endureth forever. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. People from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you for who you are. You are good, yes you are, yes you are. So good, so good, yes you are, yes you are.
You are.
You are good all the time, all the time. You are good, you are good, all the time, all the time. You are good, you are good, all the time, all the time. You are good, you are good, all the time, all the time. You are good, Lord, you are good, and your mercy endureth forever. Lord, you are good. Your mercy endureth forever. Now people from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you for who you are. We worship you. Hallelujah. Yes, you are. Yes, you are. So good, so good. Yes, you are. Yes, you are.
You are.
You are good all the time. All the time. You are good. You are good all the time. All the time. You are good. You are good all the time. All the time, you are good, you are good. All the time, all the time, you are good. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. Now people from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship you. Alleluia, alleluia, we worship you for who you are. We worship you. Alleluia, alleluia, we worship you for who you are.
Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
We will worship the King of Kings. Thank you.
when I am down. And oh, my soul so weary, when troubles come and my heart burden be, then I am still and wait here in the silence until you come and sit a while with me. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy. No life without its hunger. Each restless heart be so imperfectly. But when you come and I am filled with wonder, sometimes I think I glimpse eternity. Years ago when Pastor preached a message about living supernaturally, and he said, you've heard it, God will never ask you to do something that you can't do. He said, that's not true. God will never ask you to do something you can do without him. Amen. So if we really believe what we're singing, he raises us up to be more than we can be. So if it's something that comes naturally to us, it's not supernatural. He expects us to step out and do the things that we can't do and see what God does through us. Amen. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. Thank you. And if you say go, we will go. If you say wait, then we will wait. If you say step out on the water, and they say it can be done, the Lord will fix our eyes on you and we will come. Plans that you have laid are good and true. If you call us to the fire, you will not withdraw your hand. We'll gaze into the flames and look for you. And if you say go, the Lord will go. But if you say wait, then we will wait. But when you say step out on that water, and they say that can't be done, we'll fix our eyes on you and we will come. Because you raise me up so I can stand on mountains.
Seated if you like. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Pastor Joe, come help me.
Good morning. Good morning. Hope everyone had a great week this last week. So we're going to continue our worship. We're going to take our tithes and offerings and kind of go over some announcements. So as we are taking the tithes and offerings, all right, so the calendars are on the website now at www.ahealingchurch.com. The entire year is already on there. So if you haven't checked it out, check it out. We are continually updating the site. We're going to be changing pictures out and different things. So anyway, you can get the digital calendar on there. There are still offline copies, paper copies, on the foyer out there. So if you don't have internet or don't trust the internet, no, it's accurate. It's accurate. All right. BGMC Sunday is in 2 weeks. Is that right? No, that's next Sunday. I had to get my math right here. Next Sunday is BGFC Sunday, and my buddy barrels are gone. But if you have your loose change and you need a buddy barrel, see us at the service. We'll get you one, fill it up. It all goes to missions. It goes to missionaries all over the world, including here in the United States, to reach people for the gospel of Jesus Christ. All right, and Life for the Lost Banquet is this Thursday, 6:45 at First Assembly of God in Odessa. We need a head count. If you're going, please sign up. The sign-up sheet is in the foyer. And how many people are going, the church is paying for it. So we do need a head count. So please sign up today, this morning, right after service. And then also coming up, there's a lot of food coming up, apparently. April 1st, this is not an April Fool's joke. April 1st at 10 a.m. is this coming up Saturday, isn't it? Yes. Midland Church of God on Thomason Street, right up the road. It's $9 a person. The sign-up sheet is also in the foyer. So if you're going to that, sign up as well. And we have to turn that in, so you need to sign up today. Today's the deadline. All right. This is right. Sister Rebin's birthday shower. In lieu of presents, I'm guessing you're doing a Dorcas room shower. The registries are out there in the foyer. It's Walmart, Kohl's. The third one I don't advertise. So it's Walmart or Kohl's. Disregard the other third one. It will tell you how to look up the registry. It is a wedding registry, I believe. And it will tell you how to look up the name. Yeah, that's right. You do not have to have internet. You can go to the store. They have kiosks to print out the paper. So that is coming up Wednesday, April the 5th.
I have a question about that.
Yes.
Do I give to Dorcas or you?
Both. Just stay out of the doghouse, be both. That was pretty funny. All right. And then when you bring your items, just put them on the table in the foyer. Are we going to have a special table or?
It'll be on Wednesday night.
Oh. You're bringing them to the shower. Disregard the bottom part. Bring them on Wednesday night to the shower. It says bring items to the table in the foyer. I was just reading it. Oh, I misread it. Excuse me. I cannot read yet. All right, let's go before I dig myself a bigger hole. All right. The Ladies Shine Seminar is in Lubbock at First Assembly of God. That's going to be April 22nd. Sign up on the sheet in the foyer. We can take the church van, and there's no cost for the seminar, just money for lunch. So we do need to know if we need to take the church van. So sign up on the table of foyer. That's April 22nd from 10 a.m. to 3:30 p.m. So, and then the Ragtown Theater. There's not a sign-up sheet out there yet for that one. But if you'd like to go, please see Pastor Redmond so we can kind of figure out what date to go on. The Barnabas showing is going through April 30th. So we pick a Saturday to go. So it is really cool. We went last year. It was really fun. It was a good play. So they do an excellent job. Anyway, that's coming up. And then Wednesday night service, we eat dinner at 7 o'clock. We are in now Nahum, if I said that correctly. So be there for that. And then prayer meetings 15 minutes before service and at Saturday at 6 p.m. at the Redmond's home. If you don't know where that's at, just ask. All right. And I think that's it. All righty. Did we miss anybody for the offering? I'll make sure everybody has an opportunity. All right. Well, if you'll extend your priestly hands of blessing, we'll offer these gifts to the Lord. Lord, Heavenly Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for the honor and privilege of giving to you. Lord, that you have blessed us, that we are able to give. Lord, I ask that you have blessed the giver over in abundance, Lord. God, you bless these gifts for the advancement of your kingdom. Lord, to do the work that you have called us to do. Lord, stretch every dollar. In Jesus' name, amen.
Praise God. All right. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Pastor Joe. Appreciate your help. I just glanced at my watch. With any luck at all, you'll beat the Presbyterians to the restaurants. You are still quiet. You started off quiet and you're still quiet. This is making me so nervous. Say something, John. Yeah, even John's speechless. Something's wrong. All right. Again, it's a real joy to have everyone here today. The Lord bless you. I going to be spending a few moments this morning in the book of Jude. We were there, I think, a couple weeks ago, but I want to return to the book of Jude. We looked at the latter part of the book when we were there last. I want to look at the first part of the book today. I don't always do this. In fact, very seldom do I title my messages. But today I would like to speak to you for just a few moments on this title. The three-term designation of the believer. The three-term designation of the believer. Father, for the next few moments, please help me to communicate that which is in my heart. I pray, Father, that you'd help me to say it in such a clear and precise way that everyone in this room will understand, that there will be no confusion, that we will hear what you want to say to us and how you might want to change us through the preaching of this message this morning. We're here. You're here. Let's get together, Lord. Amen. Amen. Brother Joe is taking some pictures today for our website, and I just gave him a pose. Okay. Enough of that foolishness. The book of Jude, chapter 1. Honey, come take these keys. It just dawned on me, and they're going to bother me hanging from my pocket. Thank you. Jude chapter 1, or is it chapter 2? No, that's chapter 1. Verse 1. Jude. In the Gospels, he is known as Judas. Not Judas Iscariot, the other Judas. His real name is Judas. In this book, we call him Jude, the servant of Jesus Christ and brother of James, to them that are sanctified by God the Father and preserved in Jesus Christ and called. And there's a period there. You know what the period means? We can stop. That verse will stand by itself, although he goes on and gives us a marvelous letter. It's just that first verse that I want to look at. Do you remember the title of my message? No, you don't. The three-term designation of the believer. And they're all found, all three are found in this first verse. What I want to do, if you look at them, excuse me, they're sanctified, preserved, and called. What I'd like to do is approach these and deal with them in a backwards fashion. I want to start with called, move to preserved, not pickled, preserved, and then sanctified. Don't get me too loud. Did I just get turned up? Huh? Okay. Are we streaming yet? We're not streaming. Have we heard from Joyce?
I already talked to her on Facebook.
Okay. Okay. I'm going to be probably doing a little more teaching than I am preaching today. So if you'd like to take notes, that would be great. If not, I encourage you to write in your Bible. Highlight, underscore, write in the margins. Some things that will help you remember what I'm about to say. And it shouldn't take me but just a few moments to do this. The called. In the Greek, this word is the kletos. If you want to spell it, it's K-L-E-T-O-S in the English transliteration, kletos. It means to be invited or appointed. We find this word again in Romans chapter 8, verse 28, also 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 2 and verse 24. We are the called of God, and that is who Jude is writing to. The more common name for the called of God, those of us who are called, is what? The church. Some call it the ecclesia, some call it the ecclesia. Whatever your pronunciation is, we are still the church of Jesus Christ. So Jude is writing this letter to the church, whether they be the Jewish part of the church or the Gentile part of the church or to both. What is he talking about in the letter? He is going to be dealing with the subject of bad teaching, erroneous teaching, heresy that is coming into the church. Jude is going to straighten out some problems and issues that the first church was about to face. When he writes to them, he says, "You are the called." That means you are not where you used to be. You are where God has placed you now. Over here, you were nothing. Excuse the expression. You were a low-down, dirty sinner. You were the worst of the worst. You had no future. You had no hope. You had no plans in your life. You were over here standing alone in your sin. But something happened. The Holy Spirit began to deal with your heart, and he called you. He invited you to step out from where you were to where you were not. If we were in the kingdom of darkness, where have we come into now? The kingdom of light. And so Jude is talking to we-ins, us-ins, who have been called out of the kingdom of darkness into that kingdom of light called the Church of Jesus Christ. I keep hearing this commercial on the radio, and I won't go into a lot of detail, but it goes something like this. The speaker comes on, and he's from another church, and he says, in the Bible, there is only one Church of Christ. And you can imagine where he goes from there. And if you're not in that Church of Christ, then you're not in the church at all. Do I need to be detailed? You understand exactly what that commercial is trying to say. I am glad that God is not so narrow-minded. Story goes of a man who had passed away and gone to heaven, and St. Peter was showing him through heaven, walking down all the streets and going into the neighborhoods. And he would go into the Baptist neighborhood, and he would say, "This is where all the Baptists live in heaven." And he would show him all the great houses and, you know, and this is where the committees meet over here, the Baptist committees. And then he'd go to the Presbyterian section and say, "This is where the Presbyterians live and work, and they do all their stuff right here. And this is over here, this is where the Pentecostals live in heaven." You already knew that because that's the noisiest corner of heaven. They're over there dancing, singing, having a good time. That's where the Pentecostals live. So they walked on down the street a little bit further, and the angel, or Peter, turned to the man, and he said, "Shh. This is where the Church of Christ are. And they think they're the only ones here." I went a long way to get to that. Jude said, we are the called of God. And I don't care what the name is above your door. If you are a born-again believer in Jesus Christ, if you have accepted him as the Savior of your soul, ladies and gentlemen, you are members of the church. Baptist, Presbyterian, Church of Christ, Catholic, Pentecostal, Methodist, I don't care. It's Jesus Christ that is the subject of the church, the focal point of the church. And so Jude was saying, I want to talk to you called, those of you who have been called out of the kingdom of darkness and into the kingdom of light, those of you who have been washed in the precious blood of Jesus Christ, you are the called out ones. You are the ecclesia, the very body of Christ. He is absent and in heaven, but on earth his body still remains. We are the body of Christ. To the called, the kletos. If you did not write these scriptures down, I'm going to give them to you again in the margin of your Bible. Please write down Romans 8, 28, 1 Corinthians 1, verses 2 and verse 24. Let's back up a little bit further to that second designation. We are the preserved. Tereo. The Tereo, T-E-R-E-O, is the English transliteration. This is what it means. To guard from loss or injury by keeping the eye upon. Let me say that again. To guard from loss or injury by keeping the eye upon. I want you please to turn with me, and I'm going to read these passages. John, the book of John, chapter 17. I'm about to cough. When I do, please excuse me. I could turn my mic off. I feel better. John 17, verses 11 and 12. And now I am no more in the world, but these are in the world. This is Jesus speaking. And I come to thee, Holy Father. Keep through thine own name those whom thou hast given me, that they may be one as we are. While I was with them in the world, I kept them in thy name. Those that thou gavest me, I have kept. And none of them is lost, but the son of perdition, that the scripture might be fulfilled. It is in this passage of scripture, Jesus speaking, that we see the concept of the word preserved, meaning that we are kept in God not by our own doings, not by our own works, but he keeps an eye on us and guards over us from loss or injury. Probably a lot could be said here that I don't need to say. And so I won't say it, I guess. I am so grateful that God is able to keep that which we have committed unto him, according to the words of Paul, until that day. I am, you are, if you are the called out ones, preserved in Jesus Christ. There is not a devil in hell or out of hell that can snatch you from the hand of God because his eye is on you. The only way that you can get misplaced from his hand is if you get out of it. Aren't you glad for the choices that God has given us? I choose to stay in his hand. I choose to be one of the preserved in Jesus Christ. Thirdly, He talks about those who are sanctified. And this is probably where I want to spend more time. The sanctified by God. If you are, again, if you are taking notes, please write in the margin or underscore the word sanctified and write this beside it, hagiazo. Hagiazo. H-A-G-I-A-Z-O. H-A-G-I-A-Z-O. Probably the most of us who are in this particular corner of the church has heard much preaching on being sanctified. Remember, well, maybe you don't. I do because I'm an old head of the church. Been in it a long time. And I remember when I was a child, we'd have testimony service. How many of you are old enough to remember testimony services? There would always be at least one dear saint that would stand up in the testimony service and say something like this: I'm saved, sanctified, and on my way to heaven. In fact, as I remember correctly, there'd be more than one who would have that very same testimony. Thank God, I'm saved, sanctified, and on my way to heaven. So we who have been in the church for a long time are very familiar with this sanctification thing. However, I think that even some of the more mature saints have a misunderstanding of what this sanctification is. Go back to the testimony. I'm saved, sanctified, and on my way to heaven. When we come to Christ, yes, we do have a sense of sanctification. God has set us apart. But sanctification is not a one-shot deal. Sanctification is a process. Every day I live, I give the Lord opportunity to set me out of the world a little bit further. The irony of that is every day the enemy also has an opportunity to set me more closely to the world. And so the natural or the old-time understanding of sanctification is to be set apart. To be set apart. It is the very opposite of another Greek word called koinos. Koinos means to be defiled or common. In Scripture, and this word hagiazo, in all of its forms, whether it's sanctify, sanctified, sanctifieth, however it is found in Scripture, it is always the same verb, hagiazo, and it's mentioned 26 times in the New Testament. It is a verb. And this separation, this hagiazo, cannot be accomplished without someone separating himself. I want you to understand that. There is another word that is related to the hagiazo, which is the aphorizo. I'm not going to give you the spellings of these. You don't need really to know these. It's just the opposite. It's to set off on a boundary, a withdrawing from fellowship from the world. Let me say it more clearly. This hagiazo business is not just a matter of God setting us aside. While we do not save ourselves and we are not saved by works, still when it comes to the sanctification process, We set ourselves aside from the world. It is not the job of the Holy Spirit to pick us up in a dangerous worldly situation and put us somewhere else. I'm still not making myself clear. I can see your faces. You look like calves at a new gate. When I am placed, either by circumstances or by my will, into a situation where I can be tempted, I am given a choice. Submit to the temptation or separate myself from it. If I choose to separate myself from it, I am withdrawing my fellowship with the world. I am sanctifying myself. I am setting myself apart. Does that make sense? We have that choice. Here is a simple definition or meaning of the word hagiazo. Are you ready to write this down? To withdraw from fellowship with the world by first gaining fellowship with God. To withdraw from fellowship with the world by first gaining fellowship with God. Do you understand the weightiness of that statement? My counsel to anyone and to all of those who have come to me, I'll use that word, whining about sin that they cannot overcome. Pastor, I there's this temptation that I just can't get away from. This thing just keeps pulling me and drawing me, and I can't get away from it. I need God to sanctify me. Well, being old-time Pentecost, I understand what they're saying when they want God to sanctify them. What they don't understand is they need to sanctify themselves. And my counsel to all those that want to whine about their temptations and the sins that they're falling into, here it is. If you get closer to God, you'll get further away from the world. And there's not a one of us, including the preacher on this platform, that doesn't have room to get closer to God. Sanctification is not just withdrawing fellowship from the world, but it is gaining fellowship with God. In fact, you cannot separate until you join God. The closer you get to Him, the further away you get from the world. Does that make sense? Some of you are probably saying to yourself, boy, I'm glad I haven't gone into counsel with Pastor Redmond. You have issues in your life that you can't get over. This microphone just keeps going in and out. It's crazy. You have issues in your life that you just can't get over and get through. You have temptations that you just can't seem to overcome. There it's back again. Here is the answer, my dear friend. Be ye male or female, Get closer to God. Strengthen your fellowship with Him. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. In Jude chapter 1, we have this terminology, sanctified by the Father. In John 17, 19, we have this terminology, sanctified by the truth. In Acts 26, 18, it says, sanctified by faith. In Romans 15, 16, it says, sanctified by the Holy Ghost. In 1 Corinthians 1, verse 2, it says, sanctified in Christ Jesus. In Hebrews chapter 10, verse 10, it says, sanctified through the blood of Jesus. Not only preachers, but non-preachers, i.e. lay people, get caught up in the prepositions of these sentences. The by. How am I sanctified? It said right there, Jude chapter 1, I'm sanctified by the Father. Well, it says in John 17, I'm sanctified by truth. Acts 26, I'm sanctified by faith, by the Holy Ghost in Romans, by Christ Jesus in 1 Corinthians, and by the blood of Jesus in Hebrews chapter 10. We get caught up in the prepositions of by. Well, what does that mean, sanctified by? Forget about the preposition. Listen to what I'm trying to say. If you want to be sanctified, set yourself apart from fellowship with the world and increase your fellowship with God your Father. Period. That's it. Why make it harder than it really is? Why try to reinvent the wheel? Makes me upset, Lucy. People want to split hairs over prepositions. And some of you are saying to yourselves, what's a preposition? It's a part of the grammatical structure of the sentence. Precedes the noun. But this is not a grammar lesson. This is a message straight from the heart of God. You want to get close to Him, do so. And in your doing, you'll get further away from the world. How do I overcome that temptation? Please do not raise your hands. Don't nod your heads. Don't smile at me and don't elbow your neighbor when I ask this question. How many of you have ever been in the situation that this temptation keeps coming around and you grit your teeth and you yell at the devil and you stomp your foot and you jump up and down and you get so mad because that temptation keeps coming around? And you can't seem to overcome it. Yeah, I'm talking to you. The point, the idea of sanctification is not the fighting of the temptation, but surrendering to the fellowship with God the Father. We wear ourselves out fighting, struggling against the temptation, when what we only thing we have to do is give more of ourselves to Jesus. It's Somebody in this house needed to hear this. You know why I know that? Because I'm preaching it. This is the message God has put on my heart because somebody is struggling with a certain temptation. You're fighting. It may be years that you have been dealing with this thing in your life, and you just can't seem to overcome it. I am giving you the answer to the overcoming right now. Grow in your fellowship with God, and you'll lose fellowship with the world. We are to be in the world. We must be. But we are not to be of it. I wish I could say, as your pastor, that I have arrived. That I have all the answers to the temptations. I don't have struggles. The enemy came to me the other day. And I have learned how to respond to him, not by gritting my teeth, not by weeping and wailing and crying to God for help, or begging the Holy Spirit to come give me strength. And I'm not being sacrilegious. I've come to understand that through the power of the Holy Spirit that is in my life, I can talk to that tempter. And this is what I said to him. These are the very words I said to him. Shut up. It was over with. You know why it's become so simple? Because I have taken to heart and followed my own preaching. Every day of my life. It's the process of getting closer to Him. Getting closer to Him. Until I am so close to Him, I'm lost in Him. I am so lost in Him that the devil has a hard time finding me. Somebody better listen to me. I'll make your life easier if you'll let me. Listen to what I'm saying. By the show of hands, is there anyone in this house that does not understand what I have been trying to say to you? No one? Then I have communicated? Then there's nothing left for me to do. This message is over. Hear the word of the Lord. Let it change your life. Stop struggling. Go to God. Stand with me. Sanctified. To withdraw from fellowship with the world.
by gaining fellowship with God. Father, I pray that the few minutes that you have allowed me to share this with this congregation would not be in vain. Lord, that person or those persons in this room that struggle on a daily basis with certain sin issues and temptations, cause them to see that the sanctification process is in their hands. And as they draw close to you, they are at the same time withdrawing from the world. Let this truth sink into all of us. It's not that any of us have attained, but we will forget those things which are behind us, and we will pursue those things which are ahead. In Jesus' name. And if you could say amen, do it.
Amen.
Amen. God bless you, ladies and gentlemen. Have a great day. If you go to a restaurant, be sure and tip your waitress really good. Show the love of Jesus. If you're on the highway, the left-hand lane is for passing only. We'll be here at 6 o'clock if you'd like to join us. Amen.